Governor, how are you?
I'm doing well, Laura, and that general ought to understand that in America, when we want to make change, we do it at the ballot box.
Right. Well, I agree with you, but does it any of this bother you, kind of the deeply anti-free market strain in these protests? And look, I've been around long enough to remember the kind of no nukes protests and the, you know, all the, you know, the various protests in the 80s, and you know, we all remember those and what those were like, and it seems there's a lot of college element, it's a collegiate element, yeah, there are people from all age groups, but this is kind of a permanent protest class, don't you think? Who has time to kind of camp out in a public park, and how is that even allowed at some point?
Well, I think the cities where the protests take place have tried to accommodate the protesters, because that's what we do. You know, when I was mayor of Philadelphia, I never asked. We didn't have a litmus test for what you were going to say if you were protesting. We mm-hmm. just asked you to be peaceful and orderly and obey certain guidelines and rules. And if you did that, you could do anything you want, because that's what the country's all about. And look, I don't, you know, I wonder the same thing. I wonder how people can hang around for 6 or 7 days, you know, and
weeks.
Yeah, and weeks. But still, look. Number one, they've got a right to be there, and we all understand that. Number two, not all of what they say is wrong. There are certain things that they're talking about that I think the country has to address. I'm not sure this is the way to address them. I'd like to find out the voting history of every one of those. They're in Philadelphia right now, a couple blocks from my office. I'd like to go down and find out, is everybody registered? Did everybody vote in the last election? And not just the presidential. Did you vote in 2010? You know, because that's the way to make change in the country. And look, I think there is. And I'm certainly not an anti-capitalist. I was as business-friendly a Democrat as you're going to find as governor and as mayor. But I do think there's a growing gap between rich and poor in this country, and I think we need to address it. I do think
Well, when you say, Governor, we need to address it, and that's the rub, is it not? When we say we need to address it.
We, the nation.
And I hear you. And look, when you hear some of the things that are said at these rallies, and again, I think, and if you went down to that Occupy protest, well, don't wear a blazer, because apparently when you wear a blazer, they put you to work, Governor. They'd have you passing out the latte and the veggie burger soon, because they don't like people in blazers, so don't go down there. But the thing that I think is curious here is that we have Richard Trumka walking into the New York rally, and he said, "We're here to support you." So I guess he wants to turn it into an electoral movement, right? I mean, he wants to try to get people registered to vote and kind of turn this from this loosely, you know, formed group of a lot of college kids, postgraduates, doctoral candidates, and so forth, and turn that into some type of, I guess, political affiliation.
Sure,
right? I mean, that's kind of the ultimate goal.
Probably a good analogy, Laura, was 1968, when someone finally channeled college kids' energies into electoral politics, and they went up to New Hampshire, and they put on ties and jackets, and they went door-to-door, and they talked about the war, and Gene McCarthy got 43% of the vote and brought down Lyndon Johnson. So, yeah, I think that's what Rich Trump is trying to do. And again, look, I don't agree with their methods. I mean, the guys in Philadelphia said they're going to be here all winter. Well, that's silly. You know, you've made your point. You've gotten about all of the publicity you're going to get. Now get on with your lives, and if you really care about this stuff, organize at the ballot box. You know, we can yell on our side, we can yell and scream about the Tea Party, but the Tea Party folks understood how to make change in 2010. They got unvoted.
Right. Well, I was thinking about what you said about the protests in the 60s, and I think you're right. George Will made this point over the weekend. I think it was on ABC. Well, his point was that he hopes that the protests continue as long as possible, and, you know, it's typical Will, you know, kind of wit. And he said, well, as I recall, the Vietnam protests ended up ushering in Richard Nixon and the beginning of the rise of and resurrection of the Republican Party. And I think that there's a countervailing point here. And look, you're an old Philly guy, you're an old Pennsylvania guy, working class. And I think what happens ultimately is that if you don't connect this to the lives of regular people,
sure.
and they sort of see you encamped and, you know, the Porter John's being turned over in New York. Now Bloomberg's even saying it's hurting small businesses and police overtime, and it's costing a lot of money to the city. When that starts to happen, I think people start to get ticked off.
Absolutely.
And they say, and I think it could have a boomerang effect the other way.
There's no question. I mean, what happened, the protests, the anti-war movement in 68 was doing well electorally until the convention in Chicago. And everything blew up in the convention in Chicago, and poor Hubert Humphrey had absolutely zero chance coming out of that convention because the protest turned ugly, it was violent, it wasn't productive, it wasn't peaceful anymore, and it turned people off dramatically. And I think there is a risk here. There's a real risk here if it goes that way, and that's why, you know, the Rich Trumpkas and all those people should be talking to the protesters and say, look, you made your point. You don't think by sitting here you're going to bring about a change in law by just sitting here. And, you know, no legislative body is going to be blackmailed. But you made your point. You've gotten publicity for the things you wanted to say. Now let's get out there and organize. Go home, clean up, organize, and go. And that's what the movement... Well, clean up in the sense of, look, these people are out on the, living on the street. I mean, they're living in tents on the street, and, you know, it's time for them to start channeling their energies in something that's even more productive. Look, I think all of these things have a short-term benefit in bringing people's attention to the issues at hand. And again, I tend to agree with them on a lot of the issues. Not all, but a lot of them. Yeah, I don't think you destroy the capitalist system by any means. It's the best in the world. But I think we can reform it. I think we can police it. I don't think
when you say police it, what is it? I mean, what the heck does that
we've
mean?
We've got to have a system.
Police it now.
Laura, we have to have a system in place so the abuses that brought this country and perhaps the world to the greatest recession since the Great Depression, that stuff's not allowed to happen again. You can't let people play fast and loose with other people's money. There has to
be. Well, I agree. That's why I'm opposing the Obama administration, because I see the cylinder type junk happening and they're playing fast and loose here. Hey, Governor, what do you think? I think about someone like you, and again, Pennsylvania is near and dear to my heart for a lot of reasons. I think of someone like you, and I think, if I'm someone like a Rendell with kind of my experience, my life experience, do you think in the end that a primary challenge would have helped Obama make him a better candidate? Like, it kind of toughened him up a little bit?
Yeah, you know, you can make that case. I mean, although on the other hand, you look at Jimmy Carter and Ted Kennedy in 1980. Jimmy Carter never recovered from that primary challenge. He probably would have lost to Ronald Reagan anyway, but I don't think it helped Carter. Would it have helped Obama? Maybe so. But I will tell you, I was asked last night on some show, what chances does President Obama have of being reelected? And I said, there are three. One, for the economy to improve, and that's fairly unlikely between now and October of next year. Two, for the Republicans to nominate someone who's just goofy and the American people can't see as president. And I think that that's unlikely to happen as well. I think the likely nominee for the Republican Party is going to come across as a competent person and not a person who's wacky or anything like that. And then three, is that the Republican Congress hands him a great issue by continuing to obstruct on everything. If I were the Republicans, Laura, right now, I would be taking the parts of that job bill that I can agree to, and I would say, let's go, Mr.
Well, they
President.
Said that.
Well,
yeah, you're right. Like, but that's what Cantor
votes.
And Boehner said, though. But that's Cantor and Boehner both said right after the president's first address on the job bill, there are things in this that we can all agree on, and the president, I mean, God bless him, but the president said, we're going to do the whole thing. Yeah, but the president said it's going to be all or nothing. And even Harry Reid is not going to do all or nothing, and he's the one who stopped the thing from being considered in the Senate. I mean, McConnell wanted to vote on that thing, though, Governor.
Agreed, but the Republicans in the House control the calendar. If they want to do a bill which has some infrastructure in it, has the payroll deduction tax carry forward, has some of the tax credits for producing jobs for veterans, put five or six of those things together, get it voted on, send it over to the Senate. If they don't take action when they have a chance, I think they give the president an issue to run on and an issue to win on, because you can talk all you want about the president's approval rating. What is it, 41, 38? Have you seen what Congress's approval rating is?
Right, 11%. But they're not running for president, right?
No,
I mean, they're not, that's the problem. They're not running for president.
You can run Harry Truman proved you can run against the Congress, especially when the Congress refuses to do something. Now, I'm saying that's an issue.
That's a possibility. I hear you.
Republicans
you're
have it in their power to take that issue away, but sometimes I think that the Republican Party has a death wish.
Well, I mean, I actually agree with you on that, and in many ways, I think the Republicans can screw things up very easily, and so I'm with you on that. But when you say the wacky people, or the goofy people, would that be someone like what in your mind? A Rick Santorum, if he somehow was able to pull it out?
I wouldn't say Rick Santorum is wacky. A few of his views are wacky, but I worked with Rick. He was senator for, I think, the first 4 years I was governor, and we worked pretty well together. Now, I would say someone like Michelle Bachmann, who is out there.
Wacky.
I think some of Governor Perry's views are wacky. I mean, to say that, you know, to question evolution, to question some of the things they
No one's voting on evolution, though.
But I think you can cast, in Pennsylvania, for example, Laura, the balance of power in every presidential election, in fact, in every statewide election in the last, since 88, the balance of power has been the Philadelphia suburbs. Highly populated. It has moderate Republicans, some conservative Democrats, and a lot of Democrats who moved out of the city into the suburbs. It used to be the Republicans carried the suburbs 2.5 to 1. Obama carried the suburbs by 8, 9, 10 points last time and won the state easily. And in suburban Philadelphia voters don't want wacky. They want someone.
Well, they want jobs, too, I would imagine.
Well, they do, too, but they also want someone who, I think the Republicans are missing a bet by not taking a look at Governor Huntsman. I think Governor Romney fits the profile.
Oh, my God, you want a death wish for the party, Huntsman. Huntsman isn't going to be the nominee like I'm going to be the nominee. I mean, that's just not going to happen. But Romney could win Pennsylvania, don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely. Today, I've said publicly today, if it was Romney versus Obama, I think Governor Romney carries the state closely. But again, elections 12 and a half months away, and you know, Laura, that's light years in politics. Light years.
No,
so we'll see what happens.
Is.
But the protesters, if they want to achieve their goal, and I believe most of them do, if they want to achieve, they're never going to achieve their total goal, but if they want to achieve and make progress on their goal, get out and organize politically. That's the answer.
Yeah. They've decided not to have a list of demands, so they're just going
right.
To,
well,
you know, they don't want a list of demands. So there's a lot of you know, there's a dietitian out at the protest in Wall Street, Governor. There's a dietitian. There's a poetry seminar, and there's a life coach, and there's a notary.
Well, it's a true Renaissance experiment.
It's just funny. I mean, there's a notary.
Hey,
what are we notarizing?
Remember, they made fun of the anti-war protesters when they started out. And the anti-war protesters brought about significant change. And I'm not saying that this group can, but they can only do it if they now get off their rear ends and get out and organize. Everybody's got to register. That's what they need to do.